Hi, I'm Eddie of Eddie's Reef Aquaria. Today's video is one of the two animals that I purchased recently from Worldwide Corals. Today I'm going to talk about the Montipora Digitata. I'm going to go into basic care requirements and little specs about it. I hope you enjoy the video, you find it interesting and educational, so let's go and take a deep dive into it. Hold on. Okay, and here we are in front of the coral. Now this is what I found out. Of course, this coral is an SPS coral, standing for small polyp stony corals. Now of course, it's in the family of Montiporas. Now this happens to be what they call a Montipora Digitata coral, which are considered to be fast growing corals, and although in the SPS family, they are more hardy than Acropora corals. Now, once the coral is established, in other words, it's acclimated in your reef tank, and with proper reef husbandry, this coral can take off and grow. Now, another thing that I found out is that they tend to grow in a unique branching pattern depending on water currents and flows. Now, if there is a strong water flow, the branches will tend to be thicker versus less water flow, in which the branches will tend to be thinner. The more common colors are green, red, like this one, sometimes called also orange color, purple, and blue, with different shades of color. Now, what I mean by that is, like, for instance, this one. This one, the color of it is red, but the shade of it, it might be like a light pastel red type of color. Now, in regards to placement of this coral, it does require high water flow and moderate to strong lighting. They should be placed at about, I would say, the midpoint or mid-range in your tank, with very high flow area resulting in thicker branches with interesting growth patterns, as I said before. Now, it is considered, when I did this little research, it is considered a good beginner coral to try, to introduce yourself into the SPS family of corals. So that being said, the skill level, I would say, is between beginners to intermediate. The light level should be between moderate to high. The water flow, definitely high, because it's in the SPS families. And the disposition of this coral is peaceful. It's not going to bring out feelers and attack other corals and so on. Now, when it comes to water parameters or water conditions, well, the temperature should be around 75 to 78 degrees Fahrenheit. The DKH ranges between 8 and 12 DKH. pH, I would say, between 8.1 and 8.4, but I keep this tank at 8.0 and I really don't have any specific issues. The CG should be between 1.024, 1.026, and I happen to keep my reef around 1.026. Now, when it comes to feeding, due to their photosynthetic type of corals, they don't really need to be fed, but if so, you can feed them powdery foods or liquid foods. Now, when it comes to me and this reef, when it comes to powdery foods, I feed it, of course. If you follow me, you know that what I feed is reefoids. And when it comes to liquid foods, recently I started to feed Phytofeast from Reef Nutrition. Well, there it is. I hope you enjoyed this short video, found it fun and educational. If you did, hit the thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Now, next to the subscription button, there's a little bell. That's the notification bell. If you do that, you'll activate the notification. So every time I upload a video, you'll be the first ones to know that I uploaded one. Now, before I close the video, I thought I'd make a couple of announcements. First of all, this coming week, this Friday, the 17th, is my birthday. So I'm going to celebrate as best as I can, big time. And then the thing that I thought I mention is I'll be going on vacation this coming week after my birthday on the 17th. The following week, I'll be out on vacation. I don't know if I'm going to shoot my weekly video or not. It all depends. I might even shoot like pictures and videos of where I'm going to go, which probably I'm planning to cruise up the coast of Florida. And, you know, now with the COVID-19, most of the beaches here in Florida are closed. So I might just take like little pictures or videos of the area more or less that I'm going to be hanging out. And then the final notice that I want to make is that I went ahead and I finally got the HANA checker for phosphates, because I'm able to bring up the nitrates by feeding daily. Like I've mentioned on my previous videos, I'm feeding daily switched to frozen foods, because if you follow me, you'll notice that on the previous video, the pellets are high in nutrition. So you have to be careful when you feed fish when it comes to the pellets, because if they don't eat all of them, it is going to bring up your nitrates a bit, and you're going to have an algae issue. The algae issue, talking on that topic, is getting better, but it'll take like a few weeks to a month to see if the adjustments that I did, lighting and feeding, does work. Another follow-up on this outro is also that the protein skimmer, I decided to put it only at night. So at 10 o'clock in the evening, I turn it on and I turn it off at 10 a.m. in the morning and see if that helps, because I'm able to bring up the nitrates a little bit, but phosphates, they're still on zero, although feeding daily. So what I decided to do, of course, was get the HANA checker. I do have the Salifer test kit for phosphates, but I can barely see the discrepancy. So I went ahead and I got the checker, and there's a product that I've mentioned before, which I'm using it by Brightwell Aquatic. It's called NeoPhos, and that's to elevate the phosphates. So now that I have the HANA checker, I'm able to digitally see where it's at, and I'll be applying that product. So mentioning that, I might go ahead and do a demonstration of how to use the HANA checker for phosphates. So as I say at the end of all of my videos, happy reefing, keep safe, and I hope you have a wonderful remaining week. And until next time, bye-bye.